We're 11 or 12
some
games.
Some people are jumping on that train. I'd be quicker to jump on the Canucks train than the Oilers train at this point.
I've jumped on the Canucks train. I've jumped on the Cardiac Kids train since day one.
Cardiac Kids? You're a Washington Capitals fan now?
We get a lot of shots. Everybody come to the net. We just have to get more and more pucks to the net.
Pucks on net.
Put pucks on net. And
pucks on net.
I'm getting pucks on net.
What were you saying about putting pucks on net?
We keep putting pucks on net. We used to talk about in Vancouver getting pucks on net.
Put as many pucks on net as we can.
Putting pucks on net.
Pucks on net and driving it, making a hard night on it.
Live on tape from my West End studio apartment, a stone's throw away from the pump jack. It is Pucks on Net, a Vancouver hockey podcast that doesn't talk about fantasy or fancy stats. It is a two-man booth this week as late Tuesday morning, early Tuesday morning. Ida, day-to-day, upper body injury. She'll be back next week. But we had to change locales, Paul. Big monkey wrench into our plans.
It wasn't that big.
It was pretty big. I said, hey, you know how we do the exact same thing at the exact same time on the exact same day? We're going to need to do it in a location slightly closer to you with free parking. So I can only imagine that your day was just torn up it was just chaos.
Yeah, there wasn't even traffic on the bridge. I got here like 20 minutes early.
Yeah, we've been sitting in my delightful studio apartment. Just soaking up all that Michael's Game Center has to offer. And it's just, there we go. Edmonton Oilers lose again.
I mean, they've only lost a few times this year, right?
They were undefeated, right? That was the big thing. And then they sort of, nothing better. Sorry, folks, but there's nothing better than listening to people watch TV and slowly get comfortable, which is what I'm doing at this exact time. Well, thank you for joining us wherever you guys from. Make sure you follow us on Twitter at PucksOnNetCA or PucksOnNetCa.
Ka!
And if you do want to support the show monetarily, you can head on over to patreon.com/PucksOnNet, where you can pledge a couple of bucks.
Couple of bucks?
Mainly $5, and that'll get you instant access to all our bonus content. We got an October bonus show up there. We got 5 minutes for paying every week. You can read our cheat sheets even. Just about, we give you just about everything over there behind the sweet, delicious Patreon paywall. So it's if you got it in you, go right ahead. Paul, this podcast was delayed a day.
Yes, sir.
You're working.
Yes, sir.
And I was working. I was working on a couple of $15 arena beers at Rogers Arena last night.
As one does.
I do like, because last week Gita talked about going to the TD Garden, going to Boston, talking about $15 American beers, and a couple listeners, actually, when they heard I was going to the game, it was a DM slide. It was a messaging of how many $15 beers are you having. So I really like that the latest joke on the podcast is $15 beers. It really cracks me up. Anyway, I had two.
And if you pay $15, you're getting the craft stuff, right? That's not just for the basic, is it?
I think I had a... I didn't...
I don't sit with the peasants.
Yeah, you were...
I don't get to experience this kind of thing.
I was looking for you, and I was down in the lower bowl in the cheap seats with the bridge and tunnel, with the unwashed masses, and myself included, and I was looking up in your ivory tower. I was trying to see you.
I'm right in front of the Florida Panthers management.
I believe you were with the... I mean, the Florida Panthers have a storied history of poaching Vancouver talent.
It's true.
And the fact that you're sitting so close to them, I can only imagine that you were saying, you know that Mark Stone guy, he's pretty good. Actually, you know what you would have said? What you said, you know who's really good? Vegas. You know who's really good on Vegas? Riley Smith. You know who else is really good on Vegas? Jonathan Marchessault.
And then I got offered a job, but I was like, I don't want to live in Florida. I don't think they'd hire me. I still remember that night where Daniel Sedin pointed at the bench.
Oh, what a low life.
And I was at the elevator and Dale Tallon passed me and just kind of was like, this is bullshit. He wasn't talking to me specifically.
No, I think he was talking to you.
Was the one that received that.
You received the Dale Tallon.
I was the outlet, person who received that.
The bullshit receiver?
I guess. But I can appreciate passion like that in the management box.
Do you think that they're still upset that they basically gave away Las Vegas or Vegas's top line for next to nothing?
They've got a pretty good team right now.
They didn't look very
They've good. Got some piece. No, I know they're not a perfect team, but offensively speaking, I don't think they're too concerned about forwards.
No.
Right now. Goaltending should be better. I feel like the D is maybe what they want to work on. There's a couple of pieces there, but
guys like Branson.
Yeah, the rumor was Barkov wasn't 100% last night, so take it for what it is, and the Canucks got some early ones, and yeah. No, I talked to Joel Quenneville after the game, and he was just like, you can't do that, you know, let three goals in right off the bat. He's like, we were down 3-0 from the opening faceoff.
Yeah, it was the goals were happening so quickly. I was like, I got to stand up again. Like, I've got to hold my coat. I'm trying to drink my $15 beer.
Nachos fly all over the people in front of you.
No, I partook. This is the first game I went to this year, and I partook in my tradition of sitting on the curb across outside Rogers Arena eating chicken strips and fries from Costco.
Oh yeah, that's a good call.
And so if you see some disheveled fella in a denim jacket with a gritty pin eating chicken strips on the ground, it's not Dustin Byfuglien, but it is me. So
I mean, it could be Dustin Byfuglien.
He has a history of that. I mean, that's what needs to be outlined right now.
Yeah, no, it was a good night last night. There was random chocolate cake in the first intermission in the media box. I think it was in honor of Elias Pettersson's father's. Was it his 50th birthday?
Man's 50.
And go on Twitter, somebody did a projection. They combined current Elias's face with his father's face from when he was in his 30s, and you get to see what Elias might look like around 30, 31 years old.
He needs to lock a nice gal down early, because my bold prediction is he is going to look like Matt Sundin. That hair is just...
Everyone was making those just because his dad was rocking the shaved head at a pretty young age.
I didn't even see the photo. Like, even like most of this year, he's gonna pick that off in 5 years.
Well, if he fills out, he's gonna look like he'll look like a Viking.
Matt Sundin is a very well respected hockey player in the Swedish community. That's a Hall of Famer.
Yeah,
no cups.
So I just take, issue with you saying Elias Pettersson should lock up a wife early. Is that what you said?
Well, I mean, you should always. I mean,
maybe Ryan should take his own advice. Is that,
I'm working on it. Actually, I have good hair. My dad is the only person in either side of my family with a solid thick head of hair, and I appear to have gotten that. So
I just wanted to say, I thought Elias looked just fine.
He's handsome. He's wearing great suits. He's just spending...
With the shaved head and the beard, though.
Oh, he'd look tough. He'd look like
a tough Viking.
Olli Jokinen.
He should be shoulder to shoulder with Thor from the Avengers.
None of them went as that for Halloween.
What was that?
None of them went as that for Halloween.
Not this year.
They're more of a peaky... Is it Pesky or Peaky Blinders?
Peaky Blinders,
yeah, that's
it?
What all the Swedes on the Canucks went on, except for Petey.
Oh, that's what they were doing. I still haven't seen the show.
Neither have I.
I've heard good things, though.
Yeah, it's British. I don't know. Oh, actually, we got a lot of UK listeners. I love your style of comedy.
I watch a lot of British TV, so I don't know. That's just Ryan.
I had a great time at the Canucks game last night. You could make all the jokes you want on Twitter, but there was an uneasy feeling in the building and in the concourse when there was a 5-1 and a 5-2 lead lingering about, as that Friday night game has left a very bad taste in the mouths of fans and players when they blew one hell of a lead against the Capitals. So it was nice to see them lock it down, like Elias with his future wife.
I turned to my neighbor up in the press box and made the 5-1 lead's the worst lead in hockey joke, and we laughed about it, and then we went on Twitter, and there was about 40 other people tweeting that, so I didn't tweet it as well as say it.
In my mind, you said that in earshot of Jimbo, or Benji, and he broke his number 2 pencil in his hand. It's like, P-Mac, I tell you.
No, I was near the Florida box, so they were probably like, oh, that's a good point.
This guy's very funny and accurate.
Astute. He knows we can come back in this one.
Joel, go... Joel Quenneville we got him right where we want him, fellas. Just down by three or four goals. Nothing to worry about here.
And as soon as the first goal went on to Bobrovsky, I did also turn to my neighbors and just say, I bet Bobrovsky's out for the second period. There's no point in leaving him in if he lets in another one or two in the first.
Oh,
that's what they did. Because, yeah, once you're down and both goalies have let in a handful in the first period, go with the backup. Save the starter for the next game because you're already out of this one.
Now, I don't know their schedule. Was Florida at the end of their road trip?
Florida had just played the day before. They beat Edmonton in Edmonton 6-2 for like a noon or a 1 o'clock start on the Sunday. So, I mean, you get a day and a half instead of a day to recover from that one. But, yeah, Western road swing. Play hard to beat those vicious, undefeated for a little while Edmonton Oilers.
They had a hot minute.
And Sam Montembeau looked pretty good last year. I was singing his praises before the game started. Like, oh, you know, this could be good. Demko Montembeau.
Guys.
And then he let in, what was it, three of the first five shots got chased until he came back in. And he looked pretty good in some of the games last year. He did not look good against the Canucks on Monday night.
You know what? I love to bring this point up is because everybody can gripe about the travel and the distance that the Canucks face. And they do. And the Flyers sleep in their bed. The Flyers, the Rangers, the Islanders, they all sleep in their bed every other night, it seems like. But the Canucks, a lot of the time, are playing a lot of Eastern teams that have played in Calgary or played in Edmonton the night before. And it's a fun town. And there's a home ice advantage here. And it definitely showed Monday night against the Florida Panthers.
Potentially. We don't know exactly what happened there. But yeah, you get in after an early game on the Sunday. That is a interesting theory if some people went out that night. But yeah, first period, just not enough hustle out of some of the guys, not all the guys on the Panthers, but there were definitely a couple of plays where you watch them and there were guys just caught not moving their feet and some giveaways. And but credit to the Canucks, that was a entertaining game. They could have scored probably a couple more if a little more puck luck came in their direction. So it's exciting. Only the second team or the fourth team in 20 years to have 2 5-goal periods. I don't know if it was this early in the season or overall, but yeah, I saw some statistic like that. 5-goal periods aren't common.
No, and they've also scored 5 goals in the last 3 games, and the Canucks have only done that 3 times in their history. So it's fun. It's fun to see. And Jake Virtanen has scored 3 goals in 3 games. Shotgun Jake is back. I've noticed a trend around this time, around Halloween. We're pushing the cardiac kids, which the Canucks are. Unfortunately, I don't have Gita here to defend my honor.
Just from that one game when they came back.
They came back last on Monday night, too.
From a 0-0 score?
That's one of the hardest things to come back from. No goals on the board. How are you going to get your momentum?
I was not happy with the performance of the Canucks when they, you know, or at least with the result the Canucks got against the Capitals when they lost 6-5 after being up 5-1. But that night, Gita and Ryan were both harassing me via text message about the cardiac kids. How the Canucks came back from a 1-0 deficit 3 minutes into the first.
They're coming
in
back.
In a joking way. And I was like, and then.
Not only that, they're coming back from 0-0 ties. They're coming 0-0 deficits, 1-0 deficits.
You're taking this too far. I was just going to tell a little story bragging about the comeback kids. And then they gave up the 5-1 lead. And I said, what's the opposite of a cardiac kid?
And I was so quick to reply with, ooh, dead adults. And that's what the Canucks were. Actually, they were
in cardiac arrest.
I loved how pissed off they were. And it's just, I tweeted about it and, you know, hey, I'm not supposed to tweet on behalf of the podcasters or on the podcast itself. But if there's one thing I love, it's a lack of complacency. And I compared it to those Taylor Hall-led Oiler years where it was just, oh, yeah, you know, we didn't win. And hey, you know what? Like, on to the next one, and oh, well, whatever. The Canucks were pissed off, and they were miserable, and rightfully so. They blew a game. They gave up a crucial point in the tightest of Western conferences, and the response on Monday night was exactly what you wanted from the cardiac kids.
No, Friday night was definitely a sign of sort of, like, youth and inexperience to a certain extent, because after the 5-3 goal, the third goal, for the Caps, there was definitely a degree of tentativeness in the Canucks' play, and they looked a little panicked just because they weren't used to seeing a team mm-hmm. turn up the heat like that. And Washington has a lot of weapons. So if that could be taken as a lesson, as long as it doesn't become something that happens regularly, a couple of times this season, you're going to see a young team like that give up a 2-3-4
yeah.
goal lead. And they're hopefully going to take something from it and come out a little mad. And then hopefully the next game wins 7-2. I was a little concerned starting Demko over Markstrom because you kind of want as a goalie to give him a chance to come right back at it after that. But he's also recovering from being away from the team, not with an injury, but just like there's probably a bit of catch up work. Even if you don't go to the gym for a week or whatever, sometimes you lose a step. Mm-hmm. So he was probably happy to have the night off. And he's old enough now that he won't take the comeback loss to the Caps too seriously, in all likelihood.
It was the perfect response. And yeah, the Caps are a real team. The Panthers should be a real team. I have a surprise. You might have seen it in the group chat, but Dave putting down Dave Jr. or AJ to bed at this time. Gita out day to day. There's just you and I. I figured I would bring in somebody to chat with for a little bit.
Oh, I think I might have seen something about this.
And it's a very rare person to join us. And he was at the game on Monday last night too. And I wanted to get his opinion on some things. And he's, you know, and I think a phone call will be coming in very shortly. And it's just gonna be really exciting. And I think he's calling from soccer practice. Jeff, are you there?
It's not mine, though. I'm one of these creeper parents right now who's sitting in a car as there's an outdoor soccer practice going on. You know what? I don't know if you know it. You're not that stage in life yet.
No, I'm not. I'm not watching soccer practices from the car.
They're too wimpy to stay outside during like 7-year-olds outdoor soccer practice, so they sit in their cars with the heat on.
And then why are you doing that?
That's what I'm doing, because that's what I've turned into. I'm soft.
That's tough but fair. Okay, now on the top of the show, Paul, I was describing to the listeners how I spend my pregame routine before a Canucks game is sitting on the stoop eating chicken fingers and fries from Costco. And while I was doing that, Jeff texted me last night, and all he said was, "Do you like ketchup? Yeah or nay?" And I was curious that maybe
yay or nay.
What was it, Jeff?
It was ketchup or nah.
So did you see me consuming this like a George Costanza at tennis with ketchup all over my face? Or I'm just curious because it was like a moment from the heavens that you were texting me while I was, you know, making a fool of myself.
Well, a couple things. Costco is great for pregame, but what they've done recently with ordering at the kiosk, the self-serve thing, has turned the front counter into a war zone. So I looked up and I was like, well, there's a huge lineup of like 40 people, or there's this dog-eat-dog crowd standing by, like hustling the woman who's trying to feed everyone hot dogs. And who do I see at the front there? Sweating, nervous. Just twitching, wondering when his number's going to get called.
I didn't know you
it
saw
was
me
you.
There. And how come he didn't?
You've probably been there for like 20 minutes, and you're probably like, hold on, everything's out of order here. I got 196, and she just called 212. What's happening?
I was getting a little worried that the woman was just, she was firing out numbers with authority and dominance. And I'm like, guys, my strips and fries are just,
they don't care about order. They don't care about ordinal numbers here. They don't care about going in. It's like whatever piece of paper is in front of their face. So there was guys slowly moving their paper to the front, trying to get her to pick up on it, man.
It was. It reminds me of a general admission concert where, like, as the main act is coming on, people start inching closer and closer and closer. And by, while I was pacing and sweating and nervous that my strips and fries weren't coming, guys were just plowing through me to get their twist cones or their dogs for $1.50. And I'm like, when am I going to get my strips and fries? You were right. You can read the back of my neck perfectly. And I was nervous.
You were sweating, man. And then consuming that kind of stuff before a game too makes an even deeper sweat. So I had a dog and a drink going into the game. And then we got, like, family pack tickets, which are dope, by the way, because they give you, like, a Tim Hortons gift card, and then they give you a coupon for another hot dog and drink. So I double dogged it last night, which is even more sweaty.
So how are you feeling?
Oh, dude, it was a rough start to the day. Let's say that. It's only two washrooms at my work, too.
I was going to say, people should people should take advantage of these family deals. Because if the Canucks keep playing the way they're playing, you ain't going to be getting no free white spot gift card and free dog at the game come, you know, April this year.
Man, those are great deals, too. But then you've got this monster paw. Anyways, whatever. It was really good. Really good. And I don't even know what you guys have talked about tonight, but can I say something about the goal song?
Yeah, here we go.
It's wicked.
So you are talking about Ain't Talking About Love. You are pro-Halen in this debate, in this fiery debate.
I'm so into it, man. I woke up this morning and my kid wanted to hear it on, so now I'm introing him to Van Halen.
So this is
what? It's wicked.
I like that. Now, I will say this. I like the goal song. I never was a fan of Holiday. Paul and I beat this dead horse to death even more 2 weeks ago, but I'm glad you're bringing it up.
Okay.
Because that's fine. It's fine. Equestrian.
But the other thing, too, someone in that creative suite downstairs in the bowels of the arena has... they've upgraded their music crew. I don't know what it is. In that opening video, man, they got super grass underneath that.
Oh.
Dude, that is tight, man. I don't know who went off the chart there. It's great.
I mean, you are a fan of early to slightly mid-90s, slightly indie, you know, Britpop from, careful. I think.
Careful, man. Don't call that Britpop. That's dumb.
Yeah, all right, enough about the Stone Roses. Here was my big gripe, and I was offended by this, is that while we're talking with loving words about Van Halen and talking about love, it seems like the Florida Panthers, they went to the Roxy the night before, and they got the lead guitar player from the house band, and they said, hey, can you play Eruption in front of the arena? It was a guitar recital. And it's just one of the most painful things I've seen. And I was hoping to talk to you about this because I would say you are our resident music boy on the show associated with the podcast. So,
well, describe what happened at the game. Some of the listeners might not understand what you're talking about right now.
Well, I don't know if this happens all the time or not, but there was some kind of like terrorism on the ears last night at Rogers where they decided to, I think they just went into a Tom Lee or a Long McQuaid and grabbed some dude who was in one of those isolation chambers, you know, with the sliding glass door that someone opens it to give the guy like a little glass of water. And all you hear is like this screaming Mesa Boogie amp, some nasty ass guitar, some Ibanez. That's what was going on last night.
Oh, they
put two drummers with them. I don't even understand what was going on, man. I don't know why they were doing this.
That
was it, like guitar appreciation night?
Well, every night's guitar appreciation night. Come on, let's
go. No, every night's drumline appreciation night at the Canucks and every other team in the NHL now, because everyone's got to copy Vegas.
But no, it was.
It was like watching somebody practice. I mean, look, he's fine. It's just not. No one ever wants to hear that. I wonder if they can go off the board and just get a guy playing bass. Nothing else. Just solo bass and see how long until people revolt.
If there's a bass solo, if there's a Cliff Williams bass solo on a Bon Scott AC/DC record and Francesco hears about it, he's going to book him. He's going to go down to Long McQuaid, go into the next isolation booth and bring that guy up. And it's just a matter of time.
The poor drummer's trying to play with the guy, and it's like their drums, they're playing off of the sound of the PA, but they're trying to play ahead because the drums are echoing up. Oh, man. I mean, it's better than the house DJ, I guess, but come on.
It was a little tough, but I want to, before you wrap up, because we got to boot you off, because you got to go, have you cut the orange slices? Are they ready to go in the bucket?
No, he got a cold slice of pizza.
What was your quick takeaway of watching our delightful boys in blue and green and white put the boots to the Panthers?
Dude, four lines rolling heavy. Louis Erickson looked great, too. I hate to say that, but he looked awesome.
Well, Tim Schaller's going to make anyone look that good.
Double shifted.
Who was getting double?
Yeah, I know. he was getting double shifted, but Panthers, I mean, whatever. Panthers played, they didn't even play the night before, so they had a day and a half rest, so they were fine. Jay Beagle looking like a star. Brandon Sutter, star. Michael Ferland, he played very well for one period. But the best part about this whole thing, Jake Virtanen is now under the wing and the apprenticeship of Bo Horvat. That's apparent, and it's going to be a beautiful thing to watch.
He now has a positive mother and father figure, and it's just a matter of time. They're going to, you know, the peach pie is getting slapped out, you know, the working on the shot, shooting pucks in the dryer, that comes in. Jake's got 3 goals in 3 games. Everybody's happy.
Dude, they're a good team to watch, a ton of fun. You could see Hughes get beat a little bit in his own end, but, man, he is so amazing to watch skate. A big, yeah, anyways, good team. I got a cold piece of pizza. I got to go feed a kid. Hey, guys, good work. Take care. Talk to you later. Bye.
There goes Jeff. He comes in and out like Haley's Comet.
You had him on as like a black ace 3 years ago or something, and he's been at the Christmas party once or twice.
Jeff.
Well, I mean, he's on every episode in some ways.
Yeah, Jeff's band, old band, Lions on the Street, plays the music, the intro and the outro, and he was instrumental in. He did like a handful of episodes years ago, but he's somebody who's I find funny and whose opinion I trust a great deal. And in fact, when we recorded the first episode of Pucks on Net, I was like, I don't know if this is any good. You know, it wasn't as slapsticky as I thought, and maybe we were taking it too serious. And I sent it to Jeff, and he said that was good. And he says,
so it's Jeff's fault.
Yeah, it's Jeff's fault. You're here every Monday. In this case, Tuesday.
Thanks, Jeff.
Duncan Jeff. Hey, it's almost the midway point of the podcast. Why don't you head over to pucksonnet.ca, sign up for the Pucks on Net email newsletter, which Paul accused me of some fake news and
Ryan's. Yeah, there's a lot of inaccuracy, the typos that make him look better than he actually is, and pointing out things about one team but not about his own team that are just as equally unimpressive. Yeah, just take everything Ryan writes with a grain of salt. It's just like watching any sort of other right-wing leaning information source. Sorry, no, on either side, both sides.
Rebel Media is writing the
RNN, Ryan News Network, Rebel News Network. There's something there.
I touched on everything. I just want to say absence makes the heart grow fonder, and if you keep kicking a guy when he's down, you start to feel for him, and that's exactly what's happened with Louis Erickson. I'm the first one to say that he's probably my least favorite Canuck of maybe all time, one of the worst contracts ever. I wanted to see him play on Monday night. I wanted to see him, you know, pick himself up, dust himself off, throw him out there, work his ass off, and he did. And
got a point on one of the early goals, and
from a forecheck, from him working his ass off to make that play happen.
It is one of those things, though, you watch him out there, and I'm happy for the guy to get a little piece, and if he can stay around, if they can't figure out, you know, a better thing to do with the money as a 13th forward, he's okay in very small doses. But I did notice a distinct difference in the speed that he does not bring compared to a Tyler Mott.
You need to light
or an Adam Gaudette, for that matter.
You need to light a fire under these guys' asses sometimes, and it's just like it's easy to get complacent. It doesn't matter what nationality you are, what team you're playing from. If you get a huge contract and you can just kick back, and you know, and maybe you don't have as much faith in the team, and you've always had a pretty easy ride playing with good players, it's easy to get complacent and not want to give a fuck. And that's clearly what he did. And like, nothing bad happened. You're gonna sit for 9 games. You're gonna put the time in at practice. You're gonna work your ass off in the gym, like he was saying he was doing. And you're going to want it more. And
did he look that much different than Louis Erickson of the past few years? I didn't really think he looked different. The team as a whole played a really good game.
Yeah.
And Louis Erickson's never been, maybe I should be careful, but he hasn't been like an awful player. He's just not been a $6 million player.
He's not a $6 million player. And
so
seeing
him come back and people going, oh, he's a somewhat okay bottom 6 forward in the NHL. That's amazing. I'm so happy. I don't think he played better last night than he has at any point with the Canucks, really, overall.
Any casual fan, any casual viewer would have noticed him last night. And you notice, and and there was...
Did you?
I did notice him.
Okay.
He looked bigger, and he looked a little faster, and he was... He wants to play. He doesn't want to be forced out of Utica, and he thinks he's got a lot left to contribute. And am I the treasurer of the Louis Erickson Fan Club Vancouver chapter? Absolutely not. I still have my title as that with the We Don't Like Louis Erickson Fan Club Vancouver chapter. But I want... It's just when you just dump on a guy so much, you're just like, all right, just give us something. Just... Have some pride. Have some pride in yourself, and just do something. Don't just roll on over and die like you're the Toronto Maple Leafs. Segway.
Sure. Yeah. I'm just surprised at how excited you are about Louis Erickson. Where
exactly? Absence makes the heart grow fonder.
Yeah, I didn't really. He had a couple of hustle moments, but overall,
listen,
he just was like an adequate depth NHLer.
Hey, do you know the nickname for Tim Schaller now?
Canadian Gretzky?
It's Shalikov.
Okay.
I think it's Shalikov.
I was trying to, I don't know, go off the Dale Weiss Dutch Gretzky thing because dude's putting up goals and this ain't the Dutch league. But yeah, Tim Schaller.
Shalikov.
Was it in the preseason, someone, I think might have been the in-house Canucks social media team, did a video and they're like, which player do you anticipate other than yourself to have a really good season? And most people were like Pettersson, Besser, you know, yada mm-hmm. yada, Quinn Hughes. I feel like it might have been Thatcher Demko said Tim Schaller is going to surprise people. I could be wrong. One of the guys on the team though said Tim Schaller is going to surprise people. And even outside of the goals, Tim Schaller's really impressed me, and I wonder if whether it was injuries or confidence or whatever, he just looks like a different guy. Like, he looks like a solid, quick, heavy. We saw a little bit of it late last season. He had some good games. But, yeah, he looks like the type of guy that you overpay for a fourth liner, $1.9 million.
Yeah.
You know, even without the goals, he's been contributing quite a bit.
He's a reverse Louis. He believes in himself this year. The coach and the coaching staff obviously believe in Tim Schaller because they can't pry him out of the lineup, it seems. And it was the reverse for Louis. No, he didn't. He clearly, obviously, didn't believe in himself, and nobody seemed. And it's like, well, here's a burden. Let's just deal with it. And man, yeah, it's I like Tim Schaller is surprising the hell out of me. He's got a camp number. He's got a camp name, and all of a sudden, you give him a play on a Russian name, Shalatov, and that was his nickname on the plane, by the way. That's what they call him. He's part of the Mario Kart crew.
Yes. No. And Brandon Sutter, what do you think of Brandon Sutter this season?
Give me just shave $2 million off his contract.
Well, it's the same with a lot of guys. If he's making less money, there's not as much judgment. I don't think he's been a perfect player.
He looked good.
But he's looked really good. And I wonder, we talked about it late last season, how many games he's missed since he came to Vancouver because of all the injuries he suffered. I wonder if the guy might be feeling a little better this year than he has at any point since the first couple games he played for the Canucks.
In years past, it was, okay, everybody's hurt. Brandon, you need to do everything and keep blocking shots and keep penalty killing and play the second power play. And now he has a very...
In past years, he's been part of that everybody's hurt. He hasn't even been the guy stepping in. He's been the guy that's been hurt.
Yeah, but now he has a very specific, you know, pretty condensed role. It's like you and Beagle have the following tasks, and you're going to play with some guys that are a little more offensively gifted, air quotes, and you're not going to be expected to just carry the load because we have no idea what this team can do.
Yeah, he's had some moments with Ferland and Tanner Pearson where they've had a little give and go, and you see a little bit of offense on that third line, but you're not too worried about them defensively. No, he's a guy... I'm more open-minded about him than I have been in the past because I started to think about this the last couple games where you go, he was really hurt, and we don't always give players enough of a benefit of a doubt if you go through multiple injuries over several years, and then some guys will come out and surprise you mm-hmm. and have a really good season. Not that I'm saying he's been really good, but I don't think he's deserved a lot of criticism this year. Like, he's been there. He's been skating hard. He's been putting up offense and playing decent defensively as well. The whole team has been overachieving, really.
Well, hang on.
Most of the team.
They've been coming back, cardiacking.
That one game they came back in.
You mentioned how
they haven't needed to come back in many games. I'll just say that much. I'm not trying to insult the boys.
The
kids. Like the old Sedins.
What's that?
They just would win games. They didn't need to come back in the games.
But they also couldn't come back to win those games.
They didn't need to.
Yeah, we'll win the next one, fellas.
2011, 2012, President's Trophy's coming out the wazoo.
I could spend a whole podcast talking about how upset I was with that 2011, 2012 season and their efforts. But hey,
we've already talked about the Canucks way too much for you to get into that.
You mentioned Brandon Sutter getting hurt. Hey, is that ever the Pucks on that newsletter? Get all the injury reports there.
Right.
And so like we said at the top of the show, Gita's day-to-day upper body injury. Brandon Sutter has been here for feels like a decade, and he's been hurt most of the time. And it's really easy to forget about the injuries and the toll injuries take on teams and how quickly. I mean, we're like 13 games into the regular season, and it was relatively pretty healthy. And with teams like the Canucks, who are healthy right now, well, aside for Tyler Mott, but there's a log jam.
Antoine Roussel is still out of the lineup.
That's right, but he's been out of the lineup all year. But you have this log jam of players, then all of a sudden, you have to play every other night, and you have to fly, and it's a hard hitting, it's the fastest game of, you know, in the world, and it's the hardest hitting, and injuries start racking up, and next thing you know, my pick for the 2020 Stanley Cup champions, the Colorado Avalanche, two-thirds of their top line are injured. One is week to week, which means months. Gabriel Landeskog is out indefinitely with a lower body injury.
Is this your way of introducing your apology to me for slagging me last week?
What did I say?
In the hockey pool when Mikko Rantanen and a couple other players went out just in time for you to demolish me?
Yep. You know what? What's that? We're allowed to talk about fantasy stats. Here we go.
You know, the way you set that up, it just sounded like you were leading up to some kind of apology.
I'm sorry I beat you so bad at fantasy hockey.
That's what I was expecting, yeah.
The apology.
It's more on brand.
Not an apology. But it's like the injuries came so fast and so loose this week. It is ridiculous. You know, most of these guys play on Paul's team, but like broken hand for Ryan Murray, he's out for a while. John Tavares, he's still week to week with his broken finger. Matt Duchesne,
he's back. He played tonight.
Awesome. The Penguins, who were looking like the bad news bears, the sad sack Sandersons, there, that'll work. They at one point, like this week, they had Geno Malkin, Galchenyuk, and Dumoulin all on the IR. Thankfully, Galchenyuk and Dumoulin came out today, and they, last time I checked, they were beating the shit out of the Flyers in the Battle of Philadelphia, or the Battle of Pennsylvania. Zibanejad, this is supposed to be his Wayne Gretzky record-breaking season. He's out. It really hit hard. It really hit quick.
Yeah, I mean, the Canucks fans as well should remember, if there are guys in Utica that you want to see playing for the big club this year, you'll probably get a chance to see them, because if the Canucks have gone this far without having any real heavy injury trouble, it'll hit at some point in the season. And yeah, I hope you have a season where it's on the lower end for total games.
Yeah.
But at some point, you're going to see an Olu Levy call up. At some point, you're going to see, whether it's Sven Berchi or Nikolai Goldobin, one of these guys to get a chance to play and try to win a spot in their week or two with the big club.
They're going to be here. And if they're not, then the Canucks have won the lottery in terms of just injury, you know, luck.
And you want to have players on the farm team that you're griping about not being on the big club. Like, the good teams have a pile of players, at least, you know, a handful or two of guys, 5 to 10, that you're like, oh, I want to see him with the big club, because
yeah,
that's what the good teams do. They have not only talent, but depth throughout the lineup, and they can pull guys up. And a lot of times you have guys that might be better than your bottom six forwards, but if they're not bottom six forwards, you don't always carry them all with the big club. They go to the minors. So, yeah, injuries.
Hey, do you know Calgary, you know there was an outdoor game on the weekend?
I did, but, you know, I knew some people that were going, and the Jets are one of my teams I keep an eye on. Wearing a Jets t-shirt under this hoodie right now.
Line A?
Yeah, it's the only one I have. It was discount at the Adidas store. That's why I bought it.
Did you hear that Spezza collided with Line A in practice?
No.
I heard that. I don't know if there was any problems. You know, we got the Jets and the Ducks up on the TV here, so I don't know if they're hurt, but I just heard that was one of Spezza's first interactions with his new club, was just plowing over the franchise player.
Well, he's just trying to get traded out of town. He wanted to play in Anaheim.
He lived.
Big frustration. He signs the deal to go home, sort of. He has a home. He has a home in Anaheim.
Yep.
They're pumped to have him. Gets picked up on waivers, and they go, oh, what are we going to do? We don't have Lucas Spezza anymore. Who's kind of like Lucas Spezza? Hello, Jim Rutherford? Do you have a big defenseman you're trying to unload?
We got two of them. You want both of them?
Someone who can clear the net but may have some other deficits in their skill set?
Well, we've still got two of those.
So Erica Branson winds up in Anaheim in that slot that was set aside for Lucas Spezza, who's probably just steaming right now, was hoping to head back, and now it's like, well, you don't want both of them.
Well, he's back. The Ducks are at home to Winnipeg tonight on Tuesday night. So Spezza's probably sleeping in that bed. But it's torture. It's
grinding his teeth.
This could all have been mine. Me and my pal, Michael Delzato, and Ryan Kessler, and Kevin Bieksa, and all the former has-beens of the Canucks, down here in SoCal.
Winnipeg, Anaheim, what's the difference?
Well, that's true, Paul.
Through the winter months, really.
You know what, especially in the winter, you could drop me blindfold, spin me around at noon on a clear day. I couldn't be able to tell you where I am, Winnipeg or Anaheim.
Well, through those winter months, you're just indoors all the time, whether you're in Anaheim or Winnipeg.
And then most of the door, and it's so cold in Winnipeg, the rooms you're in don't have windows.
You're frozen shut because your door won't open because of either snow pile up or ice.
Yeah.
Sideways, raining, frozen.
That's how they sold it to Spezza when they had to go pick him up at the airport.
And I heard that's where the conditions at the game in Regina were like, and that's why it was a slower 2-1 game, is because there was a light layer of snow falling constantly and messing up the texture of the ice.
Two things about outdoor games. The first one is... This is the Low Rent Heritage Classic, the Tim Hortons Heritage Classic, the equivalent of the alternate to the Winter Classic. I didn't know that when they had the first game in Edmonton, the first outdoor game, the Oilers against the Habs, and Gretzky and Messier was still an active member of the Rangers roster, just said, hey, Slats, I'm taking the weekend off. I got to go play a game of shinny. Don't worry about it. It'll be fine.
He played in an alumni game, folks. If you're too young to remember that, he left an active NHL spot in the league to play for an alumni team of another organization. Greatest leader in NHL history.
Gotta love him. Gotta love him.
Look what he did with those high-paid Rangers teams.
Took him to the top,
in the late 90s, early 2000s, and what he did with that high-powered offense in Vancouver.
He
led them.
55 goal scorer, that Alex McGillney.
Straight. Well, that was before Mess got
here. And then Mess showed up, and he took him right to the top.
They should have slapped the C on Mike Ridley and kept him around.
If the Canucks had a nickel for every time they brought in a guy from down south, from the Rangers, that had outrageous demands and desired to live in Point Roberts for tax-related reasons, the Canucks would have 10 to goddamn cents.
At least.
At least, that we know of. Messier, Torts, maybe Mike Keenan too. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, he had that cup of coffee in St. Louis after between Vancouver. I can't remember the
Rangers,
order of things.
He left in the night to go to St. Louis, and then he went to Vancouver.
Yeah.
For those listening, and those still listening, wherever you're listening, on your commute, on your at work, on your Apple Podcast, I'm not wearing my usual headphones. I'm wearing Gita's headphones as a nod, like, you know what? Hey,
she's still here.
She's still here. They sound way better than my headphones.
Well, it's good on you for sharing the better gear with the teammates.
That's right. That's what a good captain does, unlike Mark Messier. Anyway, I didn't know in that outdoor game, because it was like, it was minus 15 or something, and it was bitterly, like, horribly cold, that Gratz had to go in to the locker rooms and convince the NHL players, the active ones, to play the real game. Because there was a lot of grumblings with the players of the NHLPA that they thought it was too fucking cold and they didn't want to play the game. And as they said during the game, that Kretz and Guy Lafleur kind of had to go in there and say, hey, suck it up. We just played an alumni game. It's fine out there. And it became one of the more famous games in NHL history.
I'd like to hear from some of the active NHL players in the room to hear how accurate that was. And
Gretz comes
a little
in.
More detail.
He was all, his face was all flush, but not from the cold because he had a rum and coke in his hand. And he's like, he called us a couple of words that we can't say on the air. And he said, I scored 50 in 07. And then, oh, wait, sorry, that was Danny Heatley. And there was.
No, he said, back in my day, it was negative 20 inside the arena in Edmonton. We didn't have heating in Edmonton back then. It was before the oil boom of the late 80s.
When you're right, you're right. The other thing, I say this every year. I'm going to say it again. I don't give a damn about outdoor games. I love what
I don't mind them. But yeah, I don't go out of my way. I knew that one was on, and if I had been home that night, I would have watched it, but I was out with some friends,
mm-hmm.
went to a restaurant. It was on at the restaurant, but we were in the half that didn't have TVs. Like, there's a bar half and a restaurant yeah. half. The bar half was full, so maybe those people were there to watch the Flames. I was down in Surrey. There's a lot of Flames fans down there.
What are you talking about?
You know, the closer you get to the Valley, the more Flames fans you
that
get.
That is false. You are gripping for straws, McClellan. And those are illegal in these
China.
Parts.
I don't know, but Raspa. The bar side with the game on was full. But yeah, I caught a couple minutes here and there, and it looked like a good presentation. I love those Jets retro sweaters.
Like, but I'm just here when I think outdoor games, there has been 28 outdoor games. That was the number. They just played the 28th. I remember the first one. I remember Sidney Crosby in the snow in the shootout in Buffalo. I remember him getting David Steckled in Pittsburgh. And I remember the one at Wrigley Field. And I think that's about it.
That's more than I remember.
And I remember the one in Boston at Fenway because Dropkick Murphys played.
You remember the Vancouver one just because that was the end of Roberto Luongo in Vancouver, probably. Although I didn't get to watch that game. I wasn't working the game, and I think I had to work something else that night.
We
so I couldn't even watch it on
the
TV.
Same place.
Yeah. No, I think I had to do something for my other job that night. There was like a live event or something.
It was a mean nothing game. Danielson got hurt. John Tortorella ruined everything. And it just didn't.
Did he? You're mad about the Jacob Markstrom pickup?
Listen, yeah, I know, butterfly effect, et cetera, et cetera. But it's not a good memory. It was like David Booth was the best player of the game from what I remember. But all these games run together, and there's no rhyme or reason for them. It's now they're just doing them to have them in as nonsensical of a location as possible. And there's going to be one in Tampa, and there's one in Dallas.
I liked the game being in Regina. If you're going to do that type of game, do an offsite game in one of these cities that's like borderline almost big enough to be an NHL city, at least in Canada.
Yeah.
Regina isn't that small, much smaller than like Winnipeg per se. And the way they support the Rough Riders makes me believe they could probably fill a 15,000-16,000 arena on a nightly basis. So, I mean, I like going into a city like that for this because otherwise, yeah, what is the game offering? But they definitely have overdone it. It should be one a year, and it should be made into a big event.
Yeah.
And a Canadian team and an American team, ideally, because if you're going to sell it in the States, you got to have one of the big American teams in it. And play it up as a once a year, once every 2 years event so that people actually care when it rolls around.
I like the idea of New Year's Day, and I think that's fine. And I hate the idea of a stadium series. I remember 5 years ago there was four or five outdoor
games. Yeah, it was getting ridiculous.
And it was just like, it meant nothing. And I tweeted out, and I spoke on not the behalf of the podcast, but if they're going to do, there should be, if they want to do, they should appeal to the Canadian markets. We deserve outdoor games up here. It's our GD game, and it's our wintry conditions. If you're going to do one in the States on New Year's Day, my opinion is do one in Canada around this time, relatively early in the season. Do it in a Canadian market. And there's two, and that's it.
I mean, isn't that the way they're kind of doing? I guess there's a few extras.
I get rid of the extras. Make it two, make a Canadian one, and you can play in CFL stadiums, and you can mean nothing. It can mean make it mean something, and give the Americans their matinee 1 p.m. New Year's Day baseball stadium moment, and then just nothing else.
They, They got to have one in Vegas soon, right? They got to commemorate that first outdoor of this era in the NHL game. That, what was it, a preseason game?
Yeah, it was Kings. Rangers, I think.
In Las Vegas in 1991 or something.
Yeah.
I can't remember the year, but yeah, we're coming up or have just passed. I don't know. We're around the 30th anniversary of that, so I'm sure the Knights will get one and probably play the Kings.
Last talking point, because we've these two-man booths, they fly right by, Paulie. I've been watching a lot of nationwide coverage about the Toronto Maple Leafs. If you watch them play the San Jose Sharks, there was a great moment where I think it was Dylan laid out Austin Matthews. They could have called it a headshot, and nobody batted an eye. Nobody shook their fists. Nobody said, hey, don't do that. And later on in the game, they absolutely laid out Tyson Barry. And Austin Matthews saw it and skated right past him. He didn't want anything to do with him. Now, I'm not, we've heard this discussion beat to death, but I'm still a fan and an advocate of intimidation being a key factor in hockey, and players will play a lot differently if they are intimidated by the other team. But if I was a player going into the, whatever the hell it's called now, Scotiabank, to play the Leafs, like I'm going to run everybody down because nobody's going to do anything. There's no response from the team anymore. And tonight they played the Capitals at home. The Capitals were clearly, you know, they were bringing a bullying aspect to the Leafs. I watched people knock over Austin Matthews' helmet. They were pushing him around, and it seemed like they needed a weekend of nationwide coverage saying they're a bunch of wimps to say, hey, no, we're not, and to respond in kind whatsoever. But there's not a very tough team.
I mean, the Vancouver Canucks have been accused of similar things.
So they bought a whole bottom six.
And people were critical of some of the players they picked up to build up to it. It seems to be working so far, having a little bit of intimidation. But I think what can be said about a lot of the guys the Canucks picked up, they may make some, you know, you look at a Tyler Myers and people talk about, you know, risky plays and missed passes and stuff. But he is a mobile, speedy guy. Tim Schaller is another good example. Like, he can skate. He's a big body.
Yeah.
But he can still move. So it's a balancing act where when you acquire these guys, Michael Ferland's another one, he can move. JT Miller, he can skate. Like, maybe you need to look at picking up one or two of those guys or swapping a guy where you're maybe at a loss. I've talked about this in the past with some of these teams like Toronto. Maybe you lose a little bit on the skill side, but you're picking up other elements that your team needs. You're selling at a loss, but if you're selling some of these high-profile players, you know, you're picking up that and maybe a scratch ticket draft pick or something that comes with it,
and
hoping to benefit from that and freeing up some salary in the process. But I don't know who that means. People have been critical of Nylander and some of these other youngsters that are on big contracts or about to sign potential extensions that'll be worth money.
Mm-hmm.
One or two of those guys may be on their way out in exchange for a guy who's not as flashy, but
a Ryan.
Can be a JT Miller maybe, who can benefit and ride shotgun with some of your high-end talent.
Yeah, and that's a good point, because I thought we were just going to go full, give me an $800,000 guy that can play 8 minutes and be a force, but not be a detriment to your success. But yeah, getting a guy that's, there's a lot of dandies on that Maple Leafs team.
Okay.
Very skilled players, very talented. And there's no doubt about it that they are one of the best teams in the East. They aren't the best. There are teams that are more skilled and better than them, but they are great. And they can score beautiful goals. And they can dazzle you, and they're young as hell, and they're exciting to watch. But we've seen them for at least three years now where they can't play a full 60 minutes. They can take their foot off the gas in the most important, significant of games and piss leads away. And it was Ovechkin today. They gave him the bulletin board material, and they're asking Ovechkin, oh, what do you think of the Leafs? And he basically said they need to stop playing for themselves. They got to realize, are they playing for themselves or are they playing for a Stanley Cup? And through his wisdom, yet broken English, he hit the nail on the head. The Leafs strike me as a team that's playing for themselves, and they're not as cohesive as they should be. At a team that talented, with that good of a coach and that good of a goaltender and that good of a reasonably good defense, they're playing for themselves. They're not they're not playing a full game, and they're, I don't know. I don't want to, I like the idea. I like Mike Babcock, but I'm starting to get the sense that the players are playing for themselves and they're not playing for him and they're not playing as a team.
Well, I've seen a lot of good coaches get fired in the past from various jobs across the league because the team needs a mix up, and that may happen.
Mm-hmm.
It's still way too early to be talking about that. I sort of brought up, like, what happens if the Canucks can't turn it around? You know, Travis Green was the type of guy who's starting to move onto the hot seat. And somebody did ask us a question, like, who's on the hot seat right now?
Mm-hmm.
May as well get to that if I'm talking about that right now.
Was that last week?
It was on here. Maybe you took it off.
Oh, Mills.
Coaches at Mills brought up, who's on the hot seat right now? Babcock, I don't think, is there yet, but he's been in Toronto long enough that this season will play a big role in
how far
along he'll stay, I think.
How many more first-round exits do you have to give a guy?
He's got a reputation. He's bought himself much more leeway than a lot of other guys, and I get that. And I'm not sure on the relationship between him and people have reported various things, the relationship between
it's
him.
It's great. It's fantastic. And that's all you got to know about.
Okay, well, yeah, there you go. But, yeah, I don't think he's coming up. John Hines, New Jersey, had some kind of high hopes. Could be
he should get
on the hot seat right now because it's been 3-4 years since he's been there, I think. And Peter DeBoer was the other one in San Jose. I actually just saw something on Sportsnet or whoever's broadcasting this game was talking about DeBoer maybe being on the hot seat. He's in his, I think this is his fourth year in San Jose. So if they underachieve for a prolonged period of time,
yeah,
they're not, you know, top of the standings in the playoff picture. It's still way too early to really look at that, but there are guys that could get dumped in the next month or two because a lot of teams, it's not even that they're bad coaches or anything. They just feel like the players need a mix up. And you bring up a good point. Babcock could be the surprising name that winds up on that firing list.
Like they're
depending on how they play.
They have 14 points in 14 games. They're like a game below 500. They're not winning. They're losing games that they're in. Like they came back and they cardiac kid their way to a 3-2 lead before blowing it in overtime. I think that that's something that you're going to have to wait till Christmas. And that's like, if this keeps up, then yeah, but it's,
and you talk about them not being physical enough, and who was the one of the only guys that was a physical player last year in the lineup, Nazem Kadri. Maybe not the best examples. You talk about whether they're playing for the logo on the front or the name on the back. He's a guy that sometimes has had a reputation. He's looked really good in the Avs.
He got lost in the shuffle down in Toronto. It's no question that he's not a third line center, and he's good. He's getting ice time. He's getting a bigger role. And when he had a bigger role before Johnny Tavares showed up, Kadri, when not suspended and not hitting people in the head, was a hell of a second line center.
And I imagine not having John Tavares in the lineup is going to impact this team. I do think he was a good influence and is a good influence as the captain of the club because he's been through a lot of stuff on Long Island and knows how to battle through some of that, because I never got the feeling he was the type of guy that just shrugged it off when he was there, even in some rough years.
Well, they'll say, the media will pick him apart and they'll say he's shrugging things off when he gives them nothing, when he gives them no sound bites. They're going to say he's not passionate enough.
Yeah, I don't know. That's not exactly how you judge a captain, but fair enough.
We'll head to the questions. And he said, Mills, our dear Pucks on Net Fantasy League player, Mills, he's a wheeler and dealer. He's a riverboat gambler. He'll offer you 10 trades a day, 20 on Sundays. He asked us about the coaches on the hot seat, and he asked us what's wrong with the Hawks. The Hawks are right around where I think they should be.
They were a team that had potential to do something. There are enough like question mark factors that if they worked out, you look at Strome last year, you look at Perlini coming in last year in that trade, both played pretty well for the Hawks, but Perlini's been, I think he's played one game this year. He's on the trading block right now. Jonathan Toews had a bit of a resurgence we've seen in the past. This year, he's only got 2 points. Andrew Shaw has only got a few points.
Brent Seabrook is barely playing. He has an assist in 9 games, and he's getting pissed off. He's kind of Louis Erickson's getting the what a consummate pro, what a guy that can handle it. Like when a guy's getting the shaft, and he's basically getting fed a shit sandwich, and then in the media he just smiles and says thank you. Brent Seabrook is just going like, I still have a lot to contribute. You guys keep writing articles about how old I am and how fast I am, but I still think that I can play. and he's getting healthy scratched, and that's, there's something happening there, and
it's finally, they're going to have to make some decisions, turning of the guard. There's going to be some pain because they've tried to keep that team that did so well, you know, 10 years ago.
Yeah.
The pieces that are still there, they're trying to just elongate this period of success as far as it'll go. And they tried to go for another year and hasn't worked so far. They are the type of team that could turn it around, I think, surprisingly. You know, a couple weeks from now, we could see them go on a run. But even the goaltending is interesting there. Corey Crawford, I think, has split all the games with Robin Lehner.
They are,
Crawford,
yeah.
They're trying to, I mean, and Crawford deserves a bit of leeway, but his numbers compared to Lehner, like Crawford is 888 save percentage.
That's a lucky save percentage.
I guess so.
In some Asian communities.
But not what you want an NHLer to be at if it's not 1985.
If Corey Crawford's save percentage was a address for a detached home in Vancouver, its property value to be twice as much as the next door neighbor.
Well, there you go. And a 3.67 goals against, and Leonard's at 935 save percentage. That's pretty good.
Actually,
he's got a pretty good track record in recent years.
I hope that whoever's still listening at this point finds my superstitious Asian address joke with real estate clever, because that's pretty good.
Yeah.
It's a thing.
And Nick Schmaltz is doing really good. As much as I talked about Perlini and Strome, they've been...
Perlini got traded.
Did he get traded?
Yeah, he got traded to Detroit, I believe.
Okay, I knew he was on the block. I didn't know if he got moved. And Strome's been good this year, but maybe not as good as people are hoping. Schmaltz is point-of-game guy in Arizona. And I noticed Dave picked him up for his fantasy team, even though he was very direct with me that Dylan Strome was way better and Nick Schmaltz was a scrub and that was an awful trade. And I said, oh, I thought it was pretty good. Both teams got a good guy.
It's almost like you two like arguing with one another.
It's wild, isn't it? But I'm glad Schmaltz is putting up points for Dave's team.
There were some questions here that came from last week, election night. We had a boatload of questions and there were some good ones, so I kept them. This is Grace. I believe she's a Patreon backer. Who's the best dressed coach in the NHL? He's back. AV.
Is AV? Yeah. I'm trying to think. Paul Maurice, I think, wears the three-piece fairly often.
Any man that's coming behind the bench with a three-piece suit, I'm happy. Travis Green, he just looks like he has to wear a suit.
Lot of guys like that. And you got Torts wearing a hoodie a couple of games.
Worst dress right there, no question. He wears that zip-up. I had no time for that.
Didn't he used to wear like a double-breasted, maybe I just picture him as a gangster
in
type.
In the 90s.
I feel like back in the day he used to wear some like big sort of.
Most did.
Gangster like look with the double-breasted pinstripe. But maybe I'm just imagining that because he's an intimidating personality.
I say my Tommy gun doesn't. Karsten Goldbranson, who we had a very good interaction with on Twitter when I said I would do a deep dive to potentially find their gender. It's actually a dude, and Paul actually met him at the draft when he took a photo with Snap's stash.
Yes, he took the photo for Snap's stash of the two of us. So I'm sorry you took us that long to figure out who you were.
But hey, now this relationship, it'll last forever.
There you go.
He asked a question that we touched on earlier, but I wanted to make sure that we gave our Karsten Goldbranson update. When will Goldobin get another shot in the show? Canucks are a different franchise. PMAC and I think if we're rambling gambling, man, we're putting our money on he'll play for the Canucks this year because there's no way that they can stay this healthy. And if they do, then they have horseshoes up their collective asses.
Yeah, he's definitely near the top of the list for call-ups. You got to think him and Sven are likely ones. Cole Lynn's been playing pretty good this year, and Zach McEwen, obviously, people like the physical element to his game. So those four should find their way up with the big club, depending on the injury pictures. But I don't think he has a lot of trade value right now. So I don't see him heading somewhere else and then burning the Canucks, ripping it up in their top six. There's just not a lot of value for him. He's turning into a Reed Boucher type of guy where it's like there's talent there.
And nobody likes Reed Boucher.
But they're right on the edge. Like in the NHL, they're a borderline, middle six forward.
They need him to light it up in the A. Injuries give him another shot. He comes back with confidence and he produces like he could be able to do if the planets aligned in the NHL, and then they ship him off. They trade him with because he's got some buzz behind his name.
Yeah, I mean, Nils Höglander is coming up behind him, and he's got the job ahead of Nick Goldobin at this point if you want just like a pure skill guy.
Yeah, he's looking good.
Did you see the move, Nils Höglander?
Yeah.
He did the lacrosse goal behind the net. Well, he passed it to himself. He banked it off the back of the net to deke out the defender, picks up the puck on his stick, bangs it in with the lacrosse style. There was a moment in the Florida game, and I don't know if it was just the angle I was looking at, and I didn't watch the replay on the televised version. I don't know. You were there from a different angle. Mm-hmm. Did it look like there was one moment where Elias Pettersson had a ton of space behind the net, looked like he was flexing the stick like he was going to try and pick the puck up with it, right after it was Brock Besser? Somebody got hit in the corner, so I was half watching the hit, half watching Pettersson move out with the puck, and it looked like he might try one of those lacrosse behind the net because they were already up 4-1 or whatever at that point in the game.
Maybe he thought about it, and if there's anybody, any player that on the team that could execute that.
Oh, he could totally do it, but it's a risky play.
Last time he was hot-dogging against the Florida Panthers, things kind of got a little messy. I don't know. Maybe he's like, maybe I shouldn't do this.
I don't think Matheson was in the lineup, though, right. So I mean.
He's still hurt.
Free reign. There you go.
We took him out.
Yeah.
Canuck fans out back. Third line, plug SenseCast. This isn't really a question to touch on. But if the NHL still allowed write-ins for the All-Star game, would Scott Sabourin represent Atlantic Division as captain? Scott Sabourin is one of my favorite feel-good stories of the year. Career AHLer, was embarrassed by the mustachioed, drunken pants-taker offer Austin Matthews in the preseason to some variety, and worked his way onto a team that had spots for him, and he's holding his own. He's living the dream, and I love to see that. So
27-year-old rookie in the NHL.
No, it's I love it.
Impressive. No. Yeah, anytime a guy can work his way in, even Darren Archibald,
exactly,
took a while to sort of, and you know, establish himself, get some games in the NHL. You always feel good for those guys because it's not easy, you know, sticking it out in the A, in the ECHL sometimes.
Yeah,
riding that bus for that many years and not making a ton of cash.
And it's just like, if you haven't seen it, go see Bull Durham, where Crash Davis, played by Kevin Costner, just tells his minor league team he's been all over the minors. He makes his way down to A-ball, and he talks about the 11 games, I believe it was, or 11 days he played in the major league. In the majors, he made in the show, and it was the greatest thing in the world. And so these guys, like we said about injuries, you forget about the human aspect of the game. These guys know they're not going to be the best players in the league or in the world or win Stanley Cups, but there's a personal pride for being an NHLer.
And they want to put him in the All-Star games. Is that called the Rory Fitzpatrick still?
The John Scott?
Well, I know John Scott's the guy that made it work, but Rory Fitzpatrick predates John Scott by 15 years or whatever, the Vote for Rory campaign?
I believe it's like 8 or 9 years. It was 07.
Was it 07? Okay.
Yeah, Brendan Morrison was still on the team, and Luongo was. Great. There's some good sound bites on YouTube.
Those, yeah, the advertisements Vote for Rory, where they would
dependable.
Be like, Nick Lidstrom was a -4 in one game 6 years ago. Is that the type of player you want in the NHL All-Star game? Vote for Rory. They had some good ones.
Rob Ducksworth, Mr. Duckworth, quack, quack, quack. He just says, how about them Comets? They're looking great. Oh, he puts an A in there, too. They are looking great.
They're the last undefeated team, I'm pretty sure, in the AHL. They haven't played as many games as a lot of teams, but they're top of their division, undefeated. You know, we talked about some of the forwards that are working, a lot of those young defensemen, mm-hmm. a lot of those college kids. You got your Brogan Rafferty types. They're all playing, pitching in, and Zane McIntyre with DiPietro as the goalie tandem's a great classic veteran AHL goalie with your young upstart potential future NHLer. You got a lot of things to like on that team.
DiPietro's undefeated. Thatcher Demko has the second best goals against with a minimum of 4 games. Small sample sizes, but you gotta love it. Chris Faber, last question of the night. Go listen to Canucks' conversation podcast, available wherever our podcast is also available. And he touches on our delightful $15 beers. I smell a shirt. So the craft beer market has a ton of different beers that you can choose from for your consumption. I'm curious if you guys have been there often, and what beer would you be okay paying $15 for away from Rogers Arena? So this is a... I'm quite shocked because...
Do they have a craft beer area in Rogers Arena now?
Yeah, but he's asking away from the arena. So
yeah,
like,
but I mean, I just wanted... I, like I said, and I'm...
$37, I would imagine.
Anyway, no, I'm glad to know the one game I sat in the crowd for last, or maybe it was the World Juniors and we were there, I did go and get a Stanley Park or whatever they had that was not whatever the normal dispensers carry. but anything, like what are the best beers right now? What are you into right now, Ryan?
Well, I'm a simple guy. My favorite not beer not named Lucky is probably, and just because I associate it with such good memories, is I'm a man that loves Pyramid Brewing Apricot Ale. They're right across the street from T-Mobile in Seattle. So I associate.
And you can get Pyramid up here.
Oh, yeah. I almost bought some on the way home at the liquor store, but I'm a fan. That's a good two-beer drinker.
What about local craft? What do you like? Is there anything that jumps out? I know you're not a snob when it comes to beer.
I don't know. I definitely love your standard East Van Brewery crawl. Nothing that stands out. I love a couple of the less egregious sours from Fieldhouse out in Abbotsford, or there's a tropical tart that Steamworks does that I love to death. And I won't get pissed drunk on them again. But Whistler Grapefruit Ale.
And you carry a lot of Stanley Park stuff, I feel like, in your fridge on a regular basis, I'll see. But yeah, Fieldhouse is one I've been trying to sing their praises for a couple years now out in Abbotsford. They're doing really good stuff. So I would also put them on my list.
Would you pay $15 for a beer if it's the right size?
I mean, probably was another event type of situation, but geez, yeah, that's a little pricey. But House of Funk on the North Shore is a new one that's really good. Those are the two that jumped to my mind. Oh, Four Winds is really good lately. I've been into their stuff. But yeah, there's a lot of good options locally. I'm probably leaving several out that people may tweet me and complain about now. But, you know, those are the ones that probably lately I would purchase.
And we're going to leave out anything else from the show because it's time to wrap it up. So two-man booth. I'm wearing Gita's headphones. Low upper body injury day to day. Thinking of our assistant captain. Her Iron Man streak still. We'll have to go in the rule book, see if it's still intact. Actually, it's not. She missed a show already this year. PMAX Iron Man streak lives on for a long time, eh?
Yeah, I gotta take a week off somewhere.
We'll put the paperwork in. And you can come to I put the word in. You can come to Monday Night Football with us.
Oh, sure.
Yeah,
sounds
the Shaw
good.
TV reunion. That'll wrap it up for this week's podcast. I want to thank you for joining us wherever you got us from. Make sure you follow us on Twitter at PucksNetCA or PucksNetCa. And again, once again, if you want to support the show monetarily, you want to help keep the lights on, pay for the Adobe Creative Suite bill, and next season get into the Fantasy Hockey League and get access to all our bonus content once a week for 5 minutes for paying, once a month for our bonus episode, get our cheat sheets that make us sound smart, although Paul has his own cheat sheets on his phone, and he does not give them up, and I respect that about him, because then all his secrets would be let out. But if you want access to all that, you head on over to patreon.com/pucksonnet, where you do pledge a couple of bucks. $5 a month, it will get you access to all our online, all our bonus audio content. And if you don't want to do that, and we respect that, because in this economy, just head on over to the Apple Podcast app or the iTunes store, give us a 5-star rating and a very positive review, and that really helps us defeat the awful Steve Jobs algorithm. And if you're an Android person, go over to Google Podcasts or Spotify or TuneIn or Stitcher or anywhere. Just subscribe, and if there's an option to rate and review, if there's an option to rate and review anywhere on Facebook, on any app, it helps us immensely. So go like us on our Facebook page. Go follow us on Instagram.
Subscribe and ring the bell on YouTube.
Ding, ding. Yeah, we have a bell. We need 100 subscribers so that we can get rid of our weird
URL.
Yeah.
And then you need another 2 million before you can start getting paid. Well, I used to get paid for my YouTube channel, and they took that away a long time ago.
Well, it's funny you bring that up, and because Jeff, I'm so glad he joined the show, joined us on the show tonight, and yeah, he's a long time affiliate of the show on a minor level. His band, Lions in the Street, his old band from Vancouver, they play the intro and the outro songs, and every Monday night or Tuesday morning, or in this case Wednesday morning, I will get an email from YouTube saying there is a copyright infringement.
So they're getting the money. At least someone's getting the money that we know.
And so they're not, our videos are not monetized, but just if you're still listening and you have a YouTube account, just go subscribe, go find Pucks on Net, just subscribe. We have like 78 subscribers. We need 100 so we can change our stupid URL. Go to YouTube and go to pucksnet.ca and you sign up for the email newsletter. And we're going to go into 5 minutes for paying now.
And if you paid for it,
yeah,
you get 5 minutes.
And I will just say, and if you haven't paid for it, I will speak fondly of it again. 2 weeks ago, probably one of my favorite 5 minutes for paying, which was me and PMAC talking about my Playboy and watching striptease. So go listen to the old episode there.